Here you go.
Cheers.
Thanks. Cheers.
I write for MB UK. Have you heard of us?
Yeah.
Well, I'm very intrigued by your story you gave the police.
Right.
I mean, it sounds just amazing. You're attacked by guys with knives and guns.
Knives, guns.
Really? Wearing ski masks? I mean...
No, it's true, man. Like, we're in London, just minding our business and just looking pretty cool, actually. Yeah. And then, sort of the three guys, black clothing, about carbons.
Five guys. At least five guys. They come out, guns, knives, and BAM!
Have no idea who wants to kill you?
I can't think of anyone.
Actually, there could be one guy.
Yeah, there is one guy.
I want these two British bunny rabbits eliminated. And I mean eliminated.
Yeah, we can get them, no problem.
Yeah. Careful, they are tricky.
That wall, there was this guy following me. I hit the wall, I got to the top, there was another guy following me down there.
So then I just jumped off it.
You guys are so amazing.
Hey,
I turned and he was still there, so I hit him with the wheel.
Oh, man, oh, man, he just knocked him clean out.
Hot in here. Guys are making me hot.
I think we score.
No, no!
Don't you know I'm in a bloody movie, darling?
Don't you know who I am?
Look, lovey, I'm in a bloody movie.
I think you will now. Pleasantly surprised, aren't you?
There you go, alright, there's the embarrassing pausey bit, right, embarrassing pause. Don't worry about if people laugh at you at the beginning if you fall off your bike, you know. Eventually you get it wired and you're the one with the last laugh.
Most of us had learned to ride a bicycle, but mysteriously, few of us had taken it any further than that. Tricks and stunts riding may look difficult and technical, but with the right approach, anyone can learn to do flash moves on a mountain bike. Whether it's starting with a simple track stand or jumping down a big drop, the mechanics of the move are within reach to anyone who applies themselves. If you have a working mountain bike, you only need to do a few things to get started. First, you should set the seat a bit lower to get it out of the way. Second, you should determine which foot is your strong foot, or chocolate foot. Like surfers or snowboarders, stunt riders have a foot they prefer to have on the forward pedal.
Like your favourite foot and favourite side. And that's like, you know, if it's steeper, then the pedal's lower. And if it's on flat ground, then it's generally a little bit higher. But that's the thing that's like creating your power to sort of do most of your tricks. But pedals and brakes and power and stuff like that. And puppy dog's tails and nice things like that.
Suspension, toe clips, and other gadgets are not necessary for tricks and stunt riding. You need a helmet, and knee or elbow pad will make you more confident so you can learn faster.
You're not filming me doing the track stand. Would you like another trick stand? Here's another trick stand. My record's 10 seconds. Ready? I have to get my pedals right. 10 seconds. Ready? One, two, go. Oh, can I do it again?
A track stand isn't flashy, but being able to track stand is considered by the experts to be the foundation of many of the harder tricks and stunts on a bike.
Track stand is vitally important.
Vital.
It's crucial.
Crucial.
Those of you who are just beginning should look for a slight incline on an object to lean the front wheel against. As Hans rides into the track stand, he wants to end up with his strong foot forward. As he comes to a standstill, he stabilizes the front wheel by turning it around 45 degrees. He can now attempt to control the balance of the bike using the pedals and the handlebars.
As you can see, I have my weight fairly far forward over my stand, and I have my pedals horizontal with my chocolate foot forward.
If the bike starts to roll backwards, he applies pressure to the forward pedal. If the bike starts to tip forwards, he releases pressure from the pedals.
You have your arms and legs kind of stretched, so you have kind of a stiff, solid contact with your body to the bike. I push my hip out. My upper body stays parallel to the handlebar, but my lower body stays kind of straight on the bike.
He should be able to stay balanced by making continuous adjustments. The track stand is not a static move where once you're in position, that's it. The more expert you become, the less visible your adjustments are to the naked eye.
Right, yeah, look.
Look at that, look at that track stand. Because it sets you up for everything. Because then like, you get yourself centered and balanced right and favorite foot ready with the power and the brakes on and all that.
For most of these trial tricks, you want to use a gear which is like a medium to low gear, I would describe it. Like, for example, the small chainring in the front and one of the middle ones in the back, or maybe the middle chainring in the front and one of the big chainrings in the back.
But you just find a gear you're happy with. Mine's like fourth, third, nines. I think mine's fourth most of the time, so.
A lot of people think for trials you need a really low gear, like, and that's not really the case, because if the gear's too low and you want to pedal, like at this exercise we just did, then there's nothing there. So you need some power, but if the gear is too hard on the other side, then you don't get anywhere, you know, out of a standstill. So medium to low gear, remember.
Okay, think of motivation.
It's just
anytime you're ready. Ready.
Yeah, I know what I'm doing.
And you're dead, dude!
With the endo, the most common fear people have is pitching over the bars, which is valid, but it will stop you from learning the move. To start with, you can practice a mini endo using the front brake to lift the rear wheel off the ground. To do the full endo, Martin starts by riding along at a walking pace. He loads his weight back slightly, almost imperceptibly. At the moment he pulls on the front brake, he throws his weight forwards. Pushing his arms forwards and down, he jumps lightly with his feet, which let the back of the bike rise up. His arms are extended but not locked. The move is not a dive over the front, it's more like doing a handstand, where your body pivots over the front wheel.
So now you roll along in like slow speed, your chocolate foot forward in a horizontal position, and then you just pull your front brake until it locks, and as soon as you feel your rear end comes up, you shift your butt back. So the more your rear end comes up, the more your butt goes back and you go in the stretched position. Roll along. Brake point, come down, and keep going.
The good must transcend the evil. It shall be done. So it has been since the beginning. Oh.
You can learn the front pivot as an extension of the endo. Using his strong foot to make a quarter pedal stroke, Martin has enough momentum to make a small endo. Only this time, he turns his front wheel in the direction he wishes to face. His upper body turns square with the handlebars, but his hips remain with the bike and are even cocked a bit further to the inside in anticipation of the move. As the back wheel lifts, Martin throws his hips around and the bike follows, pivoting on the front wheel.
You lock your front end, your back end comes up, same time. So you need that hip movement to get sideways over. Out of your hip, you swing your bike.
The power for this move comes from the hips, but the steeper the endo, the easier it is for the whole bike to pivot round.
You compress yourself within the bike, so you become a unit with the bike. That means you push your arms forward against the handlebars while your brake is locked. At the same time, you push with your feet away from your body backwards.
Eventually, you can make this move into a 180-degree turn.
I think you sort of like turn the front wheel a bit before you do the endo, and it starts moving the back wheel around. Yeah? Sort of like that. Then you can turn round, and then you can just ride away, and then you don't have to jump off the end. It's so much safer. Cool.
Just straight. Oh, mate! You're right! Nah, that was wrong. That was definitely wrong.
Oh, didn't feel right.
What happened? What was I doing wrong? I say another go.
Right on.
Go! Get up.
Are you good?
His head
hit the wall. The stoppie is an endo which you pull at full speed or while going down a hill.
One thing to remember with the stoppie is obviously it's about the brake, and we've got to use that front brake to sort of get the bike on the front wheel like before, but we don't keep it locked on. We've really sort of got to modulate it. Some people that ride with one finger might find it easier to use two fingers just so like you can modulate it a bit better, because you don't want it locked on, but you want it gripping so much that it's keeping it on the front wheel.
Martin starts by cycling at a fast jogging pace. He is standing up with his knees bent. As with the endo, he shifts his weight slightly backwards and then forwards as he pulls on the front brake. Tucking his legs underneath him, he balances the bike on the front wheel. Finding this balancing point means knowing how far forward he can go before he pitches over. You can practice the stoppie on various slopes to get the right feeling for the right balancing point. An advanced trick you can learn is to combine the stoppie with a front pivot. The result is a twisted stoppie. It's just like a stoppie, only Martin is gently turning his front wheel while using his hips to throw the back end around. He uses his front brake to control his speed. It's easiest to perform the twisted stoppie on a slope. For many of these tricks, there is a key to lifting the back wheel, which is not obvious from the outside, but is crucial for moves like the endo or the bunny hop, where the bike seems to magically stick to the rider as he jumps up. It's called unweighting the bike.
What you do is you roll along about jogging speed, and without touching your brake, you start lifting up your back, your rear end. With your cranks horizontal, with your rear foot almost vertically pointing to the ground.
The secret is in your ankles, which you use to push down, back and up. This creates a tension between your arms and legs that lifts the rear wheel.
You can try that just standing here with one foot on the ground. Try your further backward foot, not the chocolate foot. Push it back like this with your toe almost pointing to the ground and try to lift up your bike, and you will notice that you're gonna use some muscles you never really used before. And it's a very unusual feeling, but that's exactly how you lift up your bike and you steer the bike and you make it go where you want it to be.
If you learn to unweight your bike, you can eventually learn to lift it over major obstacles. Unweighting the bike is also the fundamental skill in successful jumping.
So now after you know how to lift up your back wheel, you try to do the bunny hop, lifting both wheels at the same time. Remember your foot position, push with your feet down, back, and up in one dynamic motion at the same time, lift with your handlebar.
To bunny hop, Hans approaches the jump at a jogging pace. As he draws close, he bends his knees and elbows and squats down on the bike. He's basically preloading his body and getting ready to spring upwards. His strong foot is forward and his weight is centered. As the front wheel reaches where he wishes to jump, he springs upward, lifting the bars. Now he brings in the skill of unweighting the back wheel. He pushes his feet down, back, and then up so his feet stick to the pedals. Once you can jump with the bike reasonably well, you have to learn the timing.
You find a little safe object where you can practice the timing. It has to be nothing big. Don't use a curb, because if you don't make it, you bend your rims. Just use a little stick or something. If you jump already here, you have to go very far to clear the stick. So in the last minute, you jump up, lift up your bike, and land it. So try to find the right speed. After a while, you get used to. Timing is crucial. To practice the timing, just try to lift your front wheel over it. As soon as it lands on your side, then lift your back wheel up, one wheel at a time. That way your timing gets a little more fine-tuned.
The advanced method, which you use for larger hops, is to exaggerate the two phases, lifting the front wheel and then the back. It's just like when a high jumper pivots over an object for maximum height. Martin first pulls the front wheel high. Once the front wheel has cleared the object, he throws the bars forward, then tucks the rear of the bike up underneath him. As he prepares to land, he straightens his legs, pushing the back wheel down to cushion the impact. Bunny hop is a primary skill used in jumping and catching big air.
I hit the floor with a bump across my sight. Light a cigarette and choke, then I realize it's daylight. Stumble and stagger out my room. It's penicillin for my head. I need coffee like rocket fuel. Stretch the strain, feel pain down my backbone. No time for snacks, just tactics and telephones. Snatch up the handle, list instructions. The big smoke is the venue. Rockin' a jam, it's the function. Jump, but Joe still damn from the shower. Keep the boys in the van on the hour. A simple case of motivation. No rest for the wicked in this non-stop operation. Non-stop operation. The sound of traffic clouds my brain. We're
we're sick from the diesel, but we got to play the game. The motorway is soaking wet, but the public wanna show, and it's a show the public will get. Fast food and lack of sleep, the seats in the van cut the blood off from my feet. We'll take a break just as night falls. My body's needing a service and Steve is needing his phone calls. Grab some food and some idle conversation. No rest for the wicked in this non-stop operation.
This is the lick.
We hit the south and the rain's still coming down. My country's capital, the home of the underground. Then my collar to protect me from the hail. The mansion got the sunshine in for sale. I got a mic, check, mic for feedback. Wait an hour cause I get some strength. Snap tank, got no business. I woke up with the rider. The boy snaps, so we jack the promoter. It gets delivered, so we chill. Kinda great, we got time to kill. Joints get wrapped, center stage is the destination. Just another day in a non-stop operation.
Bunny hop forwards, then you can do it to the side. You just learn to throw your body weight and the bike in the direction you wish to hop.
The parallel bunny hop can be very handy when you have to hop parallel over a rut, a root, or maybe up or down the curb. Basically, you just do a bunny hop, but you throw your weight over to the side first, and then you basically pull your bike underneath you with you while you do a bunny hop. You just take a line on the ground and try to hop over it, or put a little stick the long way on the ground, something that's not dangerous, you know. You can try it off a curb, but up a curb is quite dangerous, you know, so you want to make sure you can do it quite some height before you go on a curb.
Am I being shot watching?
Oh, good. If I hear a flop land on my head. Brilliant.
Jamie knows that.
Obviously, I'm going to do this first time. You finished? Don't you spit on me. What a brilliant wheelie.
To pull a wheelie, Martin leans forward slightly. As his strong foot comes into the forward position, he throws his weight backwards onto the seat whilst pressing hard on the leading pedal. At the same time, he pulls upwards and back on the handlebars. With the front wheel off the ground, he keeps pedaling hard.
The key is keep pedaling after you're up. A lot of people stop pedaling and then gravity will pull you down to the ground. Keep pedaling.
Once he reaches a balance point, he uses two ways of staying there and continuing the wheelie. If he starts to fall off backwards, then he has to apply the rear brake slightly. This brings the front wheel down. If the front wheel drops too far, then he pedals harder, leaning back to maintain the balance.
Your rear brake is very important so you don't tip over. I constantly have a finger on my brake and I actually track my brake the whole time, you know? And you're constantly going back and forth like this. So you always plus minus that balance point. You never have the perfect balance.
Aside from keeping your wheel up, it is also difficult to keep from tipping to the side or veering off course. You allow the bike to pivot around underneath you. You can also use a combination of moving the handlebars and sticking your knees out to keep your balance.
Same time, you have to fight that sideways balance, which throws you left and right. And this one you can correct with your legs, with your knees, with your handlebar. You can turn your bar in the air. And what a lot of people do wrong, they don't have their front wheel high enough. They have it too low to the ground, and they have their weight forward, and you just cannot last very long. This probably looks very familiar to a lot of you. They go faster and faster, and eventually they come down. Where's that done
then? If you go too slow, it goes, oh, it's not coming up, it's not coming up. Not coming up.
And if you go too fast, go on, show us what happens if you go too fast.
If you go too fast, you go.
Well, go with it.
Like that.
Then that's gonna happen.
And that'll happen. It happens to me every day.
The wheelie is a difficult trick to master. You don't need to know how to wheelie a long distance in order to do other tricks, but you definitely use the skill of lifting the front wheel when jumping up obstacles or learning to backhop. A flash extension of the wheelie is the coaster wheelie, or manual. The idea is to wheelie without pedaling, using your balance and momentum to keep the wheel up. You may find it easiest to practice this trick on a slight downhill. From the coaster, you can go on to tricks like the no-footed wheelie.
Yeah, you're looking pretty funky. Give us a spin. Yeah. Won't go up here.
Oh, he's done it! Yeah!
Be it a curb or a rock, you often have to get over obstacles with your bike.
And there's many different techniques how to get up it. You can do a fast bunny hop, you can do a side hop, or you can do what we call a pedal bunny hop. And that's the technique you can actually use the most of the times. Try to approach the step in a right angle. See, my pedal is forward, my bad pedal. Now I do a little wheelie, half a pedal stroke, and see? Now my chocolate foot is in the perfect forward position. So I can unweight my rear end and roll up on the step. Half a pedal stroke, unweight the rear end. Your feet push down, back, and up. The back foot is really important there again. That's the foot that holds the bike up, see? I can do it like this without brakes.
Stamp on your left pedal, or the opposing pedal, yeah? And at the same time, really lift it up.
and that sort of brings you through to your back to your right pedal as you land.
For objects larger than a curb, you have to pedal bunny hop more explosively. From head on, Hans approaches the ledge, ready to lift his front wheel. He paces himself so his weak foot is forwards when he's nearly at the obstacle. At that point, he uses a powerful downstroke to lift the front wheel, which he places on top of the obstacle. Notice his strong foot is now forward. With the front wheel in place, he throws his weight upwards and forwards. His back wheel is now on a collision course with the object.
And now, before your chainring or your back wheel hits the object, you have to throw your weight forward. You jerk your weight over the handlebar. At the same time, you lift with your feet.
Pushing down, back, and up, Hans unweights the back wheel enough to lift it behind him and onto the object.
When I first practiced this technique, like almost 20 years ago, I always imagined that as soon as my front wheel is up, I'm trying to kick my rear end up into the sky, you know, as high as I could, and basically get my rear end higher than my front wheel, so I have this wheelbarrow effect and I can roll out of my front tire.
An advanced technique you can learn to hop up high objects is to ram the front wheel into the top of the object. The wheel bounces upwards, giving you added lift.
If you do this technique at an object as high as a picnic table, you have only a split second time to touch your front tire on the edge, maybe even get a rebound so you can bounce up onto the table. And if the object gets much higher than that, you might not even have time to touch your front wheel at all and you have to bunny hop up directly.
We'll stand here, yeah, and just make sure, like, you know, until you sort of get to the edge. Otherwise, you're going to go too early.
Yeah, so we'll be here, and you'll be like, hey, push the front in. Push the front in.
But how can that be? Then I'll just shoot down there.
No, you won't. I promise.
Are you sure? Why can't I just pull the wheel up? Surely, I want to be pulling the wheel up.
No, see, that's the common mistake everyone makes. Really? They always think they're always front high, front high.
Listen, idiot.
I'm so bad.
Nearly had it. You're right. Didn't
go too well, lads, I don't think.
I think you had your front too low.
Yeah.
I say we set you up with something else.
Try again then, eh?
Try something else.
All right.
Come back to that.
Once you're familiar with the parallel bunny hop, you can use it in some practical situations, like jumping off a curb. If you're really good, you can even try to jump up a curb in traffic. Sometimes you have to. Those bloody buses are in your way. You gotta be committed when you do it. Lean your weight slightly over and take both wheels with you and explosively jump up.
A parallel hop up is just like the front hop up, only you lean in slightly at the beginning. As you reach the top, you use your hips and body weight to pull the bike sideways. The larger the obstacle, the more Martin crouches back for an explosive jump upwards. Martin uses the same technique to hop sideways up and over an object. As soon as he clears the object, he straightens his legs in order to absorb the landing on the back wheel.
I think I need $1 million. You need to pay me $1 million.
What are you going to do?
I'm coming at you, all right?
Well, you're going to ride off now, eh?
Yeah. Right, now I'm going to knock you out.
No.
You can learn several techniques to drop off something. The goal is to do it as smoothly as possible. Most riders like to absorb the landing on the back wheel, extending their legs to cushion the impact. In many cases, it may not be necessary to fly off a drop-off. With proper technique, you can ride a mountain bike down very steep terrain.
Rolling down a steep drop like this is not different than riding downstairs, except as steeper as it gets, as slower and as more controlled you have to do it. You wait all the way back, your handlebar straight, and roll it out with your weight back until your back end drops to the ground. This is about as deep as you can do it. You have to put your weight all the way back, go very slowly, have your handlebar straight. If it gets much deeper than that, then you have to do that other version where you have to jump your front tire out.
As it gets to that kicker we put there, it's going to go left, right, and it's going to go bang, throw the back to that
into
car.
A steep wheelie, yeah? Like really we showed steep. You, but then...
Woo. So it's like from one extreme to the other.
So you've got to get enough power in to take the bike from there, like that. So it really goes bang.
So just simulating that next drop's on the other side, and it's just practicing it, because it's all about practice. Practice, practice, practice.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can go with that, yeah?
Yeah.
The other side.
But this could be just one, eh?
If you face a drop-off where you can't ride down it anymore, where you have to jump off it, a nice way, if the takeoff surface allows it, is to pedal off it. What I do, I approach the edge fairly slow with my back pedal forward, my chocolate foot is in the back. I have a fairly medium low gear, and right when my front wheel is at the edge, I pull a wheelie and keep pedaling all the way until my back wheel is at the edge. And at that position, my chocolate foot is in the forward position to absorb the landing, and I can have a safe and straight landing. What you don't want to do is stop pedaling as soon as your front tire is in the air. Then, as soon as you stop pedaling, your front end comes down immediately while your back end is still up there and you're going to eat it. So make sure you pedal all the way until your back wheel comes off the rock. Okay, I approach the edge with my bad foot forward. Now I do half a pedal stroke, land it, and roll out of it.
In some cases, there may not be room to pedal, but the same principle of lifting the front wheel applies.
You lift up your front tire all with your arms. It's all a physical motion. You have to jerk it up. At the same time, you have to have a forward motion and leave your weight back all the way behind your seat until your back wheel hits the ground.
Drop-off technique for gap jumps. Martin lines up his pedal strokes to power wheelie off the edge and land with a strong foot forward. The main difference is that he begins the jump in a crouch, and as he comes off the edge, he jumps upwards like when doing a bunny hop, or as we will see in the back hop. He lands, legs extended, on the back wheel. Get some father choice. Batch, boil the water, hold my nose and down the hatch. Sit back, soaking up the sun rays. Eyes are pinned. It's a good thing I got my shades on, baby. What time is it? Get some, got to get some.
Like I'm walking on Velcro, feeling like fuzzy felt, and I'm buzzing in stereo. So hot, I wanna burst. I can't quench the thirst, but I can almost taste the surf. Non-stop grinning with a stiff jaw, butterflies flapping around as my brain storms. If you've been here, you know what I mean. Just the haze, confusion's the theme. How am I feeling? Yeah, feeling fine. Sitting with my boys, eating fungus and drinking wine, throwing a party without sound. About to level. no thing. When you're pinned and you got your shades on, honey. What time is it? Get some, got to get some.
Dropping off sideways, you use a sideways bunny hop, leaning in to throw your weight to the side.
It's about bunny hop and being able to comfortably bunny hop just up and down on the spot, because then that way you can sort of like move it about from one side to the other. And that's how you position yourself closer and closer to the edge until like you're literally a tire's width away from going off it. And then literally you just do another bunny hop to that side, which takes you off it, and then that's where you push the back wheel down, keeping the brakes locked on so it doesn't roll out, and then that way you get a nice smoother landing, because if you land both wheels down, you're gonna your frame, you're gonna do some damage. So hop to the edge. Bunny off in, comfortably up to the edge, push it off again.
Martin is sure to throw himself well clear of the edge. If the drop is large, he tries to force his back wheel down.
Well, you just push it down with your leg. Sort of you're bunny hopping up, but because you pushed it to the side, you're still crouched, and then like because you know you're going down, that's when you push it through with your legs. But, yeah, when you land now, your legs are straighter, and you've got a cushion to soak up the landing with your legs and your body. Then, so you're sort of ready to soak it through and push it out.
Most of the situations you face, you want to have your pedals in the parallel position, in the chocolate position, the chocolate foot forward. That way, when you jump off stuff, Your joints are free and flexible enough to absorb the shock, you know, with your muscles and joints. You have better balance with your feet next to each other instead of one foot up and one foot down.
The thing to look out for is when you start doing it off drops is to keep your bottle and just go, right, I'm going off there. Because I know I've done it, I know other people have done it, and they've sort of gone, right, even just little things, you know. I mean, nothing can really go wrong off there, and people start going, oh no, I won't do it, and then the front wheel just goes straight over the edge, and it's like, see ya, mate. It's been, I'm doing it solo, sunshine always seems to fade, but it ain't no thing. When you're pinned and you got your shades on, what time is it? Get some, got to get some. Dust your gear, yeah, got to get some. What time is it?
All I did for like 2 years was fall off. So anyone watching this video, if you want to learn to jump up curbs and stuff like that, that's cool. And it will help you do that. But if you're trying to learn the harder things, you're going to fall off a bit. So just wear the pads and the helmet and accept that fact that you may fall off. It's a good chance.
I'll try.
But before you do it.
Jesus, I've got my British brakes.
Slightly overacted.
Oh,
use your brakes, your wheels, pedals, your legs, your arms and your chest. He's gonna chuck something at me. Don't, I was just showing what you should use. It's just gonna hurt this.
There are several ways to change your direction 180 degrees. It can be done on the front wheel with pivots, on the back wheel, or completely airborne on both wheels. To turn on the back wheel, you can learn on the slope to make it easier.
That way your front wheel is up on the hill and it wants to automatically fall down once you turn.
Hans approaches the move, timing his pedal stroke so his weak foot is forward, ready for a mini wheelie. Using a powerful downstroke and lifting the front wheel, he rotates, snapping his hips and the handlebars. The bike spins on the back wheel.
And right when you start the turn, you keep pedaling half a stroke until your chocolate foot is forward, and then you turn around.
On the flat, Hans uses the back brake to freeze the back wheel for the spin.
You lock your rear brake, and then you again twist out of your body, but your rear wheel stays on the ground the whole time. You pivot on your rear wheel.
The steeper the wheelie, the easier it is for your bike to rotate. On smooth surfaces, you could even spin a full 360 degrees. If the surface is grippy, it may be necessary to make a small hop to rotate fully.
So I get my front end fairly steep up, and then to ease in the rotation, I do a hop here with my back wheel. And it doesn't take so much when you're up the steep to rotate it. A good way to approach it is with your bad foot forward, yeah, the chocolate foot back. And you do half a pedal stroke, and you pull your front end up, keep pedaling, and see for the landing, my chocolate foot is forward, so I can absorb the shock of my landing and have a good foot positioning.
Some people actually find it easier to learn the back wheel 180 by learning to rock walk.
A rock walk is a combination of a 180 on your front wheel and a 180 on your back wheel.
Doing a 180 front pivot, Hans has momentum from the rotation. As his back wheel lands, he clamps the rear brake and uses that momentum to keep turning.
Soon you land, you have your rear brake already locked. You take the momentum from your first swing, immediately stand up with your bike, pull the bike around, and again out of your hips, you turn your bike around, swing the other 180. Soon you land, you can immediately ride away before you lose your balance.
Another version of the 180 comes out of the bunny hop.
Like when you do a bunny hop, you know, and you stall the bike underneath your body, like this. Now you just like add the twist.
As opposed to a normal bunny hop, Martin loads his weight to one side. As he hops up, he snaps his hips across the bike while his head looks for the landing.
You sort of like let the brakes off, push the power down, and all at the same time you sort of turn your head and shoulders, and you sort of like, right, I want to sort of, you know, get back here. And because you've let the power off, that's what spins the bike up, because like, you lift it up through that acceleration.
You have to be very quick, very explosive, intense. You compress the bike down, you lift it up at the same time, you turn out of your hip.
Tell everyone we won't have anything to show anybody. We'll go, here, check this trick out, and I go, I've got the video, mate. See you later. But look, watch, I can do it, because your mate told me how to do it. Well done. We're unemployed.
I'm an idiot. I don't know what I'm saying. Sorry. I've messed up for myself, as much as I have for you.
It's too late now, isn't it?
Oh, no.
What are we going to do?
That's it, I'm sulking. That's it, I'm sulking. 2 hours.
It's a little tricky to learn it. Most people first learn how to hop actually backwards on their back wheel, and then maybe learn how to hop on one spot. And the hardest of all is to hop forward and maybe do a jump, a gap at the same time. Do a little endo, come down, and immediately start hopping before you lose your balance.
For the back hop, Hans starts off with a small endo using the front brake. As he comes down, he throws his weight to the back of the bike, using the momentum to lift the front wheel. Before he gets to the full standing back hop, he makes a small hop forward, placing the bike so that his weight lands squarely over the back wheel. He has the back brakes fully on. It's important to place the bike in front. If you just come up into a standing wheelie, your momentum will be backwards and you will probably start hopping backwards with little chance of recovery.
I think the reason why most beginners feel it's easier to hop backwards on your back wheel first is because instead of what I do, I lift my front end up and hop my back wheel underneath me to have my center of gravity below me. I think what they do is they throw their back, their weight too far backwards. So now they do the same thing. They lift their back end underneath them again. And they have so much momentum that they keep going and going.
I can't stop!
As soon as I get up into the back wheel hop, I usually do a hop forward to get my back wheel directly underneath me so the center of gravity is below me. I go up and hop forward, so now the bike is underneath me.
Once you've achieved the standing wheelie position, you can hop. You use both your legs and your arms to hop, making sure your ankles are soft and flexible. You should have a constant feeling that you are pushing forward with your feet. Eventually, you can learn to hop forwards.
Go on your back wheel to go forward. Just pedal in a little bit and jump forward.
The forward hop is achieved with a combination of leaning slightly forward, releasing the brake for a semi-pedal stroke, and then hopping just as the wheel propels you forward. Upon landing, you squeeze the back brake and repeat for another hop.
So when you launch forward, you give it a little pedal stroke with your feet, and at the same time you release your brake for 1 split second, but while in the air you already pull the brake again, so when you land, your back wheel will be locked and you can come to a controlled stop.
One method you can use to learn back hop forwards is to wheelie and practice a sequence of pedaling and braking, eventually at the hop.
Pedaling and braking, and pedaling and braking, and pedaling, braking, pedaling, braking, pedaling, braking.
Once mastered, the skill of the back hop is the most precise way to hop gaps and navigate difficult drops. To hop gaps, you drop the front wheel to coil the body for a jump.
The bigger the back hop, the sort of between each one, then you have to lower the front a bit more so you can get more power through the pedals. But if you lower the front, you can go a bit further.
If you wish to back hop down, you also lower the front wheel.
Basically, you land on the back wheel, like I said, hop to the edge. As it gets here, you're going to lower the front quite low. Then you're going to kick on the pedal there with your strong foot. And it's going to push the back wheel down really far. But what's going to happen, the front wheel isn't going to drop in height an awful amount. So the bike's actually not, only the back wheel's going to drop there. The front wheel's going to end up about there. So what you've done by lowering the front wheel is you've made the drop smaller than what it would be if you just went.
To hop over narrow, technical objects, the back hop is the most precise way.
Don't expect it to happen in one day, you know. Take some people years to do it, you know.
How long did it take you to learn to back hop?
I don't know, but back wheel hop or front wheel hop, one of those things I remember. First I was stoked to do 1, 2, or 3, and then maybe 5, and all of a sudden I couldn't even do 3 anymore, and then 6, 7, and then one day maybe 12, and all of a sudden you got it so good wired that you could do it, you know, as long as you had power.
Trials techniques, Josh. We've got a lovely, sweet little kicker for you here. Come along.
This looks piss easy.
Okay, does it matter which pedal I have in front, strong foot forward?
Doesn't really matter.
One thing you should look out for is the back hitting that lump and kicking you over the bars, so be ready for that. Oh, yeah, right. Okay, right. No problem. It, yeah? No problem.
All right, then, let's go. Come here.
Oh my God. It's like that wasn't right, was it?
You silly Billy.
You really did mess that up.
I think I should watch a video.
I think you should.
Just a freak brother living off the land. If it's free, I've got to get some, find a choice. Batch, boil the water, hold my nose and down the hatch. Sit back, soaking up the sun rays. Eyes are pinned. It's a good thing I got my shades on, baby.
What time is it? What time is it? Get some gas again.